Today is the 11th day of the 7th month on our Maker's restored calendar. It is the 4th day of the 9th month on his servant Satan's calendar. Yesterday's Day of Atonement, aka Day of Covering, has brought forth an 11-day journey to the last day of this dual-year period of time. The Most High has orchestrated this two-year period of time to come to an end on the last day of his Feast of Ingathering on his restored calendar. The last great day of this feast is the day that his only begotten Son stood up and cried aloud the following: If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink, according to the scripture that says, He that believes into me, rivers of living waters will flow out from his belly. Since the revelations of Yeshua tell us that the name that his Father gave to him is the word of Elohim, from a third-party perspective, we can substitute his references to himself with the name that his Father gave to him. Therefore, these two verses tell us that Yeshua stood up and cried aloud, If any man thirst, let him come unto the word of Elohim and drink, according to the scripture that says, He that believes into the word of Elohim, rivers of living waters will flow out from his belly. If you believed into the word of Elohim like I do, you would be here at the place that Yahweh my Elohim has chosen for his name to dwell here, standing with his anointed. And you would be able to drink of these living waters with me. These living waters are the waters of the Most High statutes, including the waters of his waters of separation statute and his touching the naked and dead life of Adam statute, that he turns into his only begotten Son shed blood in order to cover our sins and give us life. He has sent forth his dual anointed sons with the testimony of his word and with what causes him to turn the waters of his statutes into these living waters on our behalf. He does so when we obey his voice with the burning desire to become as he is. The Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel gave us three tiers of 11 days journey in the testimony of his word. They parallel the last 33 petitions of this dual year period of time, counting the three petitions to him that went forth from his holy mountain today, on the day that this video is being sent forth, on the first day of these 11 days. The first of these three tiers of 11 days follows the 10th day of the first month, and it takes us to the last day of his 7-day feast of that which is unleavened. The 10th day of the first month is the day that his word commands us to set aside the Passover lambs or goats in order to celebrate his Passover memorial 4 days later. It is also the day that he caused our ancestors to pass over the Jordan River on dry ground after he dammed up the river at the city of Adam that is on the side of Zaratan. The city of Adam that is on the side of Zaratan is one of several references that the Most High gives to us in the testimony of his word that are from A to Z, referring to from Adam to Zerubbabel. The 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 12, associates Zaratan with being beside Megiddo and Beth Shean and below Jezreel and Abel Meholah and across from Jokneam. Megiddo means a rendezvous or a gathering, as in the Most High gathering the heathens together to battle at this time, and also him gathering the remnant to him at this time. Beth Shean means house that is at ease, referring to those of you that are at ease at this time that do not fear the Most High's hot indignation, thinking you're going to get raptured away and such. Jezreel means Elohim will sow seed, referring to him planting the seed of the remnant at this time. Abel Meholah means meadow of dancing. Jokneam means the people will be raised. The seed of those of you that will turn back to the Most High are indeed going to be raised up and dancing with joy in green pastures after the dust from the coming fall settles. 1 Kings chapter 7, verse 46 tells us that Solomon had all of the vessels of Yahweh's house cast from the clay that came from the soil that is between Zaratan and Sukkoth. Sukkoth is the plural of the Hebrew word for a booth, or for a temporary dwelling. Yahweh also calls his Feast of Ingathering his Feast of Booths, that I also often refer to as the Feast of Temporary Dwellings. Zaratan comes from a word that means to pierce. To pierce is a reference to him causing his only begotten Son to be pierced when he caused our ancestors to have him killed. These are the only three places that Zaratan is spoken of in the testimony of Yahweh's word with this word. However, 2 Chronicles refers to this place with a similar word that also means to pierce. In light of Yahweh causing his only begotten son to be pierced in the side in order for the waters and the blood to be able to flow out from him, and in light of what Yahweh has caused his second anointed son to speak about him turning the waters of his statutes into his only begotten son's shed blood, and in light of his only begotten son standing up on the last great day of the Feast of Temporary Dwellings and crying aloud, "If any man thirst, let him come unto the word of Elohim and drink," according to the scripture that says, "He that believes into the word of Elohim, rivers of living waters will flow out from his belly." Do you think that Yahweh causing his servant Solomon to make all of the vessels that were for his house from some clay that was from the soil that was between a place that he caused to be named pierced and a place that he caused to be named temporary dwellings is a coincidence? The 10th day of the first month is also the day that he caused his only begotten son to ride into Jerusalem upon the ass's colt. Jerusalem means to teach completeness. It does not mean the city or the foundation of peace, or even to teach peace, like some so-called scholars claim that it does. Yahweh gave the name Jerusalem to us in the dual form of the Hebrew language. He did so because there are dual Jerusalems. The second of them is referring prophetically to the chief seat of the scattered descendants of Israel at this time. This is the great Elohim-like city of America. The Strong's Concordance tells us that Jerusalem comes from Strong's number 3384 and from Strong's number 7999. They are partially correct with this, however, not exactly. Strong's number 3384 means to teach or to point out. Number 7999 means to pay for something or to recompense for something. Therefore, according to these words, Jerusalem means to teach payment or to teach recompense. And this is true in part. However, if we let Yahweh's word testify to itself, Jerusalem actually comes from Strong's number 3384 and number 8003. The way that we can know this is because Melchizedek, the priest of the Most High Elohim, was king of Salem, and Salem is Strong's number 8004, which is the same word as Strong's number 8003. Strong's number 8003 means to complete something. Therefore, the dual form of the Hebrew word for Jerusalem means to teach completeness. Is it a coincidence that his word tells us that his teacher of righteousness that he was going to send to us at this time was going to put completeness upon his altar? When I said that the Strong's is not entirely wrong in saying that Jerusalem comes from Strong's number 3384 and 7099, I say this because number 8003 comes from number 7099. To pay for something or to recompense something completes the transaction. And this is what Yahweh is going to do when he recompenses you for your rebellion to him. He is going to make an end of your doing so. Melchizedek means king of righteousness or king of that which is right in the Most High's dual eyes. Yahweh's first 11-day journey following the 10th day of the first month and taking us to the completion of his feast of that which is unleavened is indeed fitting. It is his unleavened bread of life that completes us. It does so when we walk with him, living upon every word that he sent forth from his mouth. This 7-day feast ends 4 days after he resurrected his only begotten son. I will speak about the significance of this in relation to his waters of separation and his touching the naked and the dead life of Adam statute and the last 4 days of his Feast of Temporary Dwellings in a bit. The 10th day of the first month is also the day that Yahweh gives to us in association with chapters 40 through 48 of his end time son of Adam prophecies. These 9 chapters give us his measurements and his instructions that are for his house at this time. The second of his 3 11-day journeys was the 11 days that it took our ancestors to journey from his holy mountain that was at Horeb during the first Exodus that brought them to the entrance of the land that he had summoned to give to them. They refused to trust and obey him, so he sentenced those of them that were 20 years old and upwards as of the first day of the second month, minus Joshua and Caleb and their families, to die in the wilderness over the course of the following 38 years. Likewise, the scattered descendants of Israel have refused to trust and obey him at this time and go up to possess the land that he has sent to give to you, So likewise, he has sentenced those of you that were 20 years old and upwards as of the first day of the second month of this year to die in the wilderness over the course of the following 38 years. However, you can still turn back to him and obey his voice for your seed's sake, or even do so in order to give yourself a chance to be resurrected to life at the great white throne. The third 11 days journey that his word gives to us is the current 11 day journey that follows his day of covering that was yesterday on the 10th day of the seventh month. Not only does this 11 day journey take us to the last great day of the Feast of Ingathering, aka the Feast of Temporary Dwellings, it is also the last day of the Most High's appointed time, dual appointed times, and half of an appointed time. And it is the last day of the dual overlapping 9-month periods that bring forth the second of the dual man-childs. The first of these 270-day periods ends today. Today also brings the completion of the first 10 days of the last 20 days of his Haggai prophecy. A heap of 20 have indeed become 10 per this prophecy. In the last video that was called a Yellowstone Caldera exclusive, I said that if Yellowstone did not blow at 7:34 a.m. yesterday morning, that it will blow forth during the coming 11 days or immediately after them anyway. Yellowstone did not begin to blow forth yesterday morning. However, the Most High certainly caused some significant things to begin to happen in the hours that led up to yesterday's day of covering. He sent forth a 4.3 earthquake that was quickly followed by a 5.3 that shook the earth west of Yellowstone's border. And these dual quakes have continued to be followed by a very lengthy series of large aftershocks since then. He also caused the dual childlike leaders of America and North Korea to up their war cry to one another by causing North Korea's dictator to play with some very powerful fireworks. This explosion caused a shaking of a 6.3 on the Richter scale. This 6.3 shaking parallels Yahweh's Psalm 63 prophecy that was part of his fulfillment of his small cloud that is like the palm of a man's hand / Elijah / fruitful garden prophecy. What I spoke about in the last video about yesterday's 7:34 a.m. 188 1/2 day waypoint did not nullify Yahweh's 188 1/2 day quake cycle. It actually set up a seventh such quake. Yesterday's 6.3 shaking was a very, very big shaking. I say this because it will bring forth World War III. Yahweh orchestrated this shaking to occur at 3:30 a.m. UTC. This parallels things such as the 330 days that he caused his servant Noah to remain on the three tiers of the boat after he shut off the floodwaters from gushing upon the earth, and the 3 30-day periods of time that he orchestrated as part of his restoration of his 30-day months. And this 6.3 shaking fits snugly into this 188 1/2 day pattern with the first day of the first month in the matter that I spoke of in this video. It is just that it was not yet at 7:34 a.m. and not yet according to the time zone that I spoke of. Therefore, this shaking happening at this 188-day waypoint brings forth a seven such quake scenario that overlaps this sixth shaking of the earth. In light of this sixth shaking of the earth lining up with the 188-day cycle in the manner that I spoke of in the last video, is it a coincidence that this 6.3 shaking was a result of the sixth nuclear test that the Most High has orchestrated through North Korea? In the Yellowstone exclusive video, I spoke that this 188 1/2 day on average pattern parallels the actual 188 1/2 days that encompasses the time that we are to eat his Passover memorial each year and the last great day of his Feast of Ingathering on his restored calendar. Therefore, the very, 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 very great shaking is yet to come on the actual 188 days that this pattern was created upon. I have spoken about how the seven days of the seventh trumpet will follow the end of the last great day of the feast in many of these videos. Well, in chapter 16, verse 18 of the Revelations of Yeshua, we are told that such a great earthquake that will divide the city into three parts will bring forth Yahweh's seventh messenger pouring out the seven vials of the seventh trumpet of his hot indignation. This is all coming together in a spectacular way, with the Most High holding back this until the last possible moment that he is able to, with still being able to accomplish why he is sending this time of calamity forth at this time. Revelation chapter 8 verse 5 tells us that these seven trumpets are also preceded by the earth shaking. Ultimately, the shaking is referring to the great shaking that Kikwe has sent me with to wake you from your slumber with the warnings that he has sent me with. However, you would not be awakened. So now he is going to do so with a great number of physical shakings. Could it be that this sixth 188-day shaking is the actual physical shaking that precedes Kikwe, the beginning of the actual physical shaking that precedes Kikwe, letting loose the actual physical effects of the seven trumpets? I'm not sure how he is going to cause these final 10 days to unfold that follow today. However, I do know what they are going to bring forth. And I know that he has put a lot of emphasis upon these last 10 days, and even an extra emphasis upon the sixth day of them. The sixth day of them is the 17th day of this seventh month. Towards the end of the 17th day of the seventh month is the time that he marked his servant Noah, and it is indeed as it was in the days of Noah. This day was 110 days after he shut off the waters. 110 is one-third of the last 330 days of the account of the flood. Yet we spoke to his servant Elijah, my predecessor, towards the end of Elijah's 40th day upon his holy mountain at Horeb. This was also towards the end of the 17th day of the seventh month. When he did so, he gave his servant Elijah the vision that was of the mighty spirit that rent the mountains, and the great shaking, and the refiner's fire, and the small quiet voice. This vision was for the manner that Yahweh has sent me to you. The 17th day of the seventh month is the third day of his seven-day Feast of Huts. Therefore, there will be 4 days that are left to go of his appointed time, dual appointed times, and half of an appointed time at this junction. Like with Yeshua's resurrection at 3 a.m. towards the end of the third day of the Feast of That Which Was Unleavened on the 17th day of the first month, this parallels the third day of the 7 days of Kikwe's waters of separation and his touching the naked and the dead life of Adam statute. This statute tells us the following. He that touches the dead life of any Adam shall be unclean for 7 days. He shall purify himself with the waters of separation on the third day and 4 days later on the seventh day, and he will be clean. But if he does not purify himself on the third day and 4 days later on the seventh day, he will not be clean. Whosoever touches the dead life of an Adam that is dead and does not purify himself defiles Yahweh's dwelling place, and that life shall be and has been cut off from Israel, because the waters of separation were not sprinkled upon him, and he is unclean, and his uncleanness remains upon him. You are getting ready to be taught that your uncleanness remains upon you, and that you have been cut off from being Yahweh's people. You are getting ready to be taught that you are the naked and the dead life of Adam. These final 10 days bring forth another shortening of the days. There being three petitions to him per day upon his holy mountain means that there will be 30 petitions to him during these final 10 days. These 30 petitions parallel his dual 30-day prophecies. 10 days is one-third of the 30 days paralleling his prophecies that are for a third part. These dual 30-day prophecies tell us the following. You, referring to the children of Israel, have transgressed. You have practiced deceit against Yahweh, because you have brought forth children that are strangers to me. Henceforth, referring to at this time, a month will devour you amongst your portion. And in Zechariah chapter 11, verse 8, 1 month is hidden or concealed from three shepherds, for I loathe their lives, and their lives will also be reaped. Yahweh has funneled these 30 days into these 30 petitions that are contained in the last one-third of them. He has indeed continued to shorten the days of letting loose his wrath. However, how much longer can he hold this back and still accomplish why he is sending it? I do not know. However, I do know that you are running out of time to believe him and turn back to him before he causes you to believe him. The last great day of the feast also brings an end to the 84-day period that encompasses his Feast of First Fruits and the last day of this feast. I have spoken about how these 84 days represent the time that his second anointed son is dead upon the wide pathway of Sodom and Egypt, and the time of my resurrection in several of these videos. The last day of this feast is 106 days from the fifth day of the fourth month. The significance of the fifth day of the fourth month in relation to his opening wide of his end-time son of Adam's mouth is discussed in several recent videos. The Most High opened the door of the three tiers of the ark 106 days after he caused his servant Noah to let loose the first dove and the raven. The three tiers of these three 11-day journeys that Yahweh gave to us in the testimony of his word are indeed awesome in what they point to. They point to the journey into the place that he has summoned to those that will obey his voice. I could keep going on and on with how the last day of this feast fits into the testimony of his word and into his end-time timeline, because how it does so seems to be without end. Yahweh, my Elohim's word is indeed awesome, and so is he. And it is indeed going to be awesome to be in the place that he has summoned to those that obey his voice.